have two seats right here. Tonight, we are really thrilled to be hosting visitors and residents to give this phenomenal presentation, Connecting with the Archives, Reclaiming Memory. Mette Kia Krabbe Meyer is right here. She is from the Royal Danish Library. Mathias Danbolt is here from the University of Copenhagen. Katrine, I never say it right, and I'm not even trying the rest, is a senior fellow. Postdoctoral fellow at the Royal Academy of Art. I said that right. Ms. Vaughn Belle, artist, historian, educator, mom, and all great things. And David Berg, photographer and new researcher. He's begun to dive deep into the archives. They are here and all working with us on our summer program with students between the age, actually our youngest is 10, between 10 and 17, where they are being introduced to all of this information and to our history, and they're integrating art. And in the afternoons, we have two wonderful activists and organizers out of New York who are working with the same photographic and imagery, working with the young people on learning how to activate their voices on issues that they have determined they want to address. So we have, she's not here, we have a leading activist, Mo George, who heads up a homeless organization in New York, and she's just recently been named one of the top 50 activists in New York City. And Taisha, who heads up Fury, which is a youth organization. So our young people are having an incredible experience, and today was day two. So I'm going to shut up and turn it over to the presenters. I want to thank you all for coming. Bear with us. This is an old building, and somebody said they're going to help us get air conditioning, but then I showed them the thickness of the walls. These buildings were not built to be air conditioned, so we've decided that we're just going to sweat it out, hopefully the fans will help cool you down a little bit. For those who need water, there's a water cooler in the back here. For those who are able, there's a bathroom upstairs. For those who are less able, there is a bathroom right around the corner here. We have just rescued two little tiny kittens, and they're in the bathroom. So just be careful to keep them in when you go in. And that bathroom doesn't have, our plumber hasn't come yet to finish the hookup on our sink, but we do have hand sanitizer in there, okay? Toilet works fine. Any questions? No? Thank you all.
All right. Thank you, friend Ellen. Thank you, Chant. Thank you all for coming tonight. We have five presentations today in this order, about like 15 minutes, 10, 15 minutes each. And then we will have a conversation with all of you afterwards. And of course, you can interrupt if you have immediate questions. But we have quite a packed program, so bear with us. But of course, if you have things, you know, if we speak too fast or too weird because we have different accents, you know, stop us. This is also about trying to be in dialogue with each other. So my name is Mathias Danbolt, and I'm an art historian working at the University of Copenhagen. And my little presentation today, I'm going to call it Documents of Denial, Art in the Service of Colonial Power and Ignorance. So the conversations we will be having today is in part about how some of the artists on the panel have been working art, using art as a tool of critiquing colonialism and reclaiming memory. What I will be presenting is a bit some of the opposite. I will be giving you some information about some of the art that was created during colonial reign on the Virgin Islands, but by Danes, by the colonizers, for the colonizers, that in many ways can be said to work quite opposite of what the later artists have been doing, where art has actually been used as a tool of power. And the context of this presentation is in part related to an exhibition that I was part of curating in Copenhagen last year, together with Mette Kia Krabbe Meyer and our colleague Sara Giersen, an historian. And this exhibition that we put up in relation to the centennial at the Royal Library in Copenhagen kind of came out of two big motivations. First of all, the fact that a lot of work has been done by historians, both in Denmark but also here on the islands, about colonial history. I'm coming from art history. There's not been done almost any work in art history, specifically not in Denmark, on this historical material. So images have been used in books a lot as illustrations, but never really been thought of critically as a source to history. So what we wanted to do, or I wanted to do as an art historian, was in part to think critically, what kind of images, what role have they played during colonialism? And try to kind of kickstart the discussion within art history and among artists. But a lot of that debate has been inspired by artists like Vaughn and some others in the room. So we wanted to get kind of art historians to think and work with this material and to show and find out what material is actually in the archives. Because since there has been done almost no research, we didn't know what kind of material, like imagery that had been created during colonialism that has ended up in Danish archives. Because if you go through museums, there is nothing. If you go through the Danish National Art Gallery, you would never know that Denmark had colonies. Because that's just another story that had been told. It's been a story that has been forgotten, or not necessarily forgotten, basically ignored in very many ways. So as an art historian, I was interested in trying to do something with that ignorance, so try to kind of open up the material. The other kind of entry point to this archive, or this exhibition, was the fact that during the centennial, a lot of archival material has been digitized. When Denmark sold the islands, as you know, in 1917, Denmark brought a lot of the archival material back to Denmark. Some also went to the US. So a lot of the archives, specifically the kind of ledgers of economy, of plantation, of enslavement, went to Denmark. It has not been accessible for people except if you went to Denmark. And last year, the National Archive in Denmark digitized more than 1 kilometer of archival records, like 2 million documents, that has now been accessible online. We'll talk more about that later. But we worked together with Mette Kia at the Royal Library. We looked at the Royal Library's collection that has a lot of image material. That was not necessarily material brought back to Denmark after the sale, but this is material that has been donated by Danish families, photo albums, postcards, so a lot, and also maps that has been given or ended up in the Royal Library. So what we did, we tried to look through these archives to see what kind of images have been created of the Danish West Indies during colonial times. We also then looked in other kind of image archives. When we went to art museums, we realized that art museums had not really collected any of this material, in part because the artist who were here was not necessarily looked upon as important enough. But so we went to ethnographic collections, that where we found a lot of image material, or in the Maritime Museum that has been interested in imagery because it has related to the history of maritime ships and boats and so forth. So we, after doing a lot of work for over 2 years and also visiting the island and talked to people here, we created an exhibition called Blind Spots, Images of the Danish West Indies Colony. So as the title indicates, what we were interested in was not presenting how history was, but how, if you look at the images that have been produced by Danes for the Danes, what kind of idea of colonialism does that promote? What kind of idea of history of colonialism can we see in these images? And to kind of put it shortly, that's a very romanticized idea of colonialism. It's a very beautiful idea, this history of colonialism, that we kind of argue, we wanted to make, examine, to say that maybe images have actually worked and really worked as a powerful tool in creating a narrative in Denmark about colonialism as not that bad. So we wanted to think critically and ask people, the visitors, to think critically in the role of images. In order to do that, we also teamed up with contemporary artists, among others, Vaughn Belle, that we had in the show, but also works by Jeanette Ehlers, who are also here with us today, a Danish Caribbean artist. And we worked with some, I'll come back to that, about some contemporary artists that pointed to the absences in the historical archive, the distortions of images, how images have created romanticized, problematic histories. One of the first kind of image categories that we looked on and looked at was the category of maps and cartography. Because maps is such an extremely important tool of colonialism. So when the Danes came to or bought St. Croix in 1733, the first thing they did was to get land, like people to map the land in order to take over the land, to parcel it up, and to sell it. So we kind of dig in different archives and we found one of the first maps of St. Croix that was made in 1750, that is in the Danish Geodata Agency. And some of you might know these maps because they have circulated in different ways, but they haven't really been discussed critically as a visual source of history. And this map, you know, I could go into talk long about all of these things, we can come back to it, because if not, we will stand here for days. So just I'm gonna go a bit quick through some images just to show you some of the material that we have found in the archives and that we are now wanting to work and continue working on and discussing. So this kind of early map, it's a very, very detailed map. It almost gives you like an image of how quickly the island was turned into the plantation economy. You can see here, this is where we are now in Frederikstad. This is before Frederikstad is made, it's organized properly. And you can see the plantations that are popping up. And you can even, and the cartographers have painted in where there's been growing cotton, where it grows sugar cane, which is the yellow. And it gives us this quite interesting image. It's an interesting and problematic source of history that we wanted to kind of challenge and look into. This map that came a couple of years later was what was really used in colonial reign. As you can see here, it says the list of who has bought each property. And that used for colonial, like the selling of the plantations, creating the plantations, this grid structure that was made. Like, artists was part of organizing this, of making these grid structures, of thinking and creating an image of conquest of the islands. And here you can see a list of who has bought all the plantations. So, you know, maps was also used as a source of income, of taxation and selling. And we wanted to examine the different ways that maps, as a category that we use all the time, like Google Maps and everything, but this is not a neutral category of image. This is a very loaded, politically, ideologically loaded category that has been used for so many different ways. But this was the cartographer behind this map. Yes, David Berg was also the guy who laid out the plan for Frederikstad. You can see here on the map, this is Frederikstad. But of course, this part of Frederikstad was never built. So the map isn't necessarily truthful. It's also an ideal map of how it should become. So you know these images are not necessarily always truthful in any way, but they have played a role in history, and that's also what we wanted to examine. And then also some later maps that was made strategically in order to protect the colony. That's why there was some interest in this area, Maroon Ridge. You know, suddenly the cartographers realized that we need to find out more about where people can hide, where people, the enslaved, can hide. So they ordered a new map that could be used to protect the colony. So mapping was one way that we've been interested in examining. But then my research has been specifically also about how painters have worked during colonial reign to create this kind of rosy, beautiful image of enslavement. And kind of erase the violence and kind of portray history of slavery to the Danes in a more kind of beautiful manner, which of course is deeply problematic, but that's why we need to talk about it. So I've been interested in and worked quite a lot with one specific painter, Frederick von Scholten, who was the customs officer here in Frederikstad from 1834. And he painted a lot of vistas of the island, specifically of St. Croix and all the plantations from the 1830s to 1850s. And this one from Frederikstad is, I think, particularly kind of telling for how a lot of these images have worked. Here you have the artist who kind of jumped off this horse and who's sitting with perhaps an enslaved man holding his umbrella, and he's kind of painting the beauty of the landscape. So the beauty of the landscape is kind of central. But of course, the landscape is a landscape that has been violated by enslavement and plantation economy. And you can of course see here the enslaved laborers in the field. But this image is meant to show the beauty of the landscape. So these kind of crashing of different perspectives is quite kind of central in a lot of these works. And there are a lot of these images that we also kind of wanted to examine and look into. I don't know if you know this one, it's pretty close. We went the other day with David. This is his grandmother's backyard in Hans Bay. But also from here, from Lagrange, house you can still kind of find today. But I've been interested in how these images, you know, they pop up and are used uncritically, as this is how the colony looked. But this is a very specific view of colonialism that these images show. This is the planter's view of colonialism. This is the power, the Danish view of colonialism, that minimizes the role of violence, that minimizes the role of enslavement. It's been important to try to think critically what happens when this is the imagery that has been circulated, this is the imagery that has been archived, and not the imagery from the perspectives of the enslaved, from the perspectives of the Afro-Caribbean laborers. So I've been interested in what we tried also in the exhibition is to examine how these images, they may also be said to be documents of denial and ignorance. These are images that erase the history of violence. Because they almost never ever show the plantations how it really was. There are all these idyllic scenes, but this is the scene that depicts, you know, the most important element of harvest of sugarcane. This was not a peaceful moment, but the paintings presented like that. So now to just kind of round up, we also tried to focus on how in the archives, what imagery of enslavement that is there, which of course is a very taxing and difficult matter. And we couldn't find anything from the perspectives of the enslaved. So there's like a lot of blind spots, but there were a lot of kind of these more violent images of plantation production. We have the runaway slave ads, we have the abolitionists, and we have a lot of paintings in the Danish archives of white men. That's kind of what we have most of. And a lot of pictures of someone like Peter von Scholten. We even have like a movie made, and it was a musical made, this kind of story of the white hero that so-called liberated the enslaved. So we were interested in the exhibition to say, well, what happens when these are the images we have, and we don't have images of General Budo, we don't have the images in the archives of the leaders of resistance. We wanted to point to the problems of the archive in that way, which is why we worked with artists and included works, for instance, a video work by Jeanette Ehlers, who is here today, or Would Be Good, that kind of deals with the erasure, with the absences in the archives. We had pieces by Vaughn Belle that she will be talking about later. And then we kind of rounded up the exhibition with a history of photography when photography was introduced. That happened almost at the same time as the abolition of slavery. So we don't have photographs of enslavement, because photography was really introduced around the late 1840s. But here, of course, in these imagery, we do have finally visions of the formerly enslaved and the Afro-Caribbean laborers, but they're always presented also in Danish albums, photo albums. So, for instance, of this daguerreotype picture, we know, luckily, the name of both, because they were written on the behind, but this is part of the white woman's, the Bauditz family's private album. But we know the name of the wet nurse, the nanny, called Charlotte Hodge. But this is not her family picture, this has been part of a Danish album. But so what we have been interested in doing is to, because now this imagery is finally available online, and we kind of try to contextualize and show how, like, the enormous production of photographs and postcards from the island that was produced from around 1880s and onwards. And because of the arc of the way it's created, we don't know the names of the people, the Afro-Caribbean people in these photographs, because they have not been written in the albums. We almost only have the name of the white people in the albums. But what we have hoped, and why we are also here, is to, you know, create a dialogue, because now this imagery is available, it's online, and now we can kind of start really to in many ways share it in order to get these out of just the Danish white family albums and hopefully to see if we can find the names of people and that these could be introduced back into the community that they were kind of taken from in so many different ways. And we also hear work with Lavon, but she will be presenting this afterwards. So I think I'm kind of round up there and give the words to Mette Kia. Thank you.
There are folks outside. There's room inside, but there are no chairs. We sort of oversold. So come on in with the littles. We have like seating space on the floor if you don't mind, or if, I'll give up my chair. Thank you. It's a good problem to have.
I'm going to take over from Mathias and tell you a little bit about how we, like, also from the beginning of the work with the exhibition and with the digitization, how the work that we've been doing, the research and the stories that we've been telling, has not been the only thing that's been in the project. From the beginning on, we wanted other voices than our voices to be heard. We wanted to be in dialogue, and in the exhibitions, for instance, we worked with art historian Timmy Odomozu, who created different workshops in which artists, students, activists were confronted with some of the images that we were going to show, and they had a dialogue. And she recorded this dialogue and turned it into sound bites that you could then actually listen to when you were visiting the exhibition. Because one thing is a text that you read on a wall written by someone like us, like a curator, but another thing is actually to be listening to the words of somebody looking at this image and discussing it. For instance, the daguerreotype that Mathias just presented to you had this kind of little sound insulation by it, and I'm just gonna play just a little bit of it to you so you can hear what it sounded like.
Because it's really a picture of the daughter, it's centered on her, and so the Crusian woman is having to fit into that. Because especially with adults and children, you know, it could have been the adult standing in their normal position, and then the child has to kind of ease up to the adult, and you kind of get them in this other frame. But she's sitting comfortably in the center, and then the lady from St. Croix kind of has to put her fit herself into that.
For a second or some minutes, they're kind of in it together, like feeling a kind of limited freedom and trying to act it out, right?
But you can still see who is in control. I mean, the girl is extremely, like, she's posing, but she doesn't really seem that content, or like, she seems a bit kind of disengaged or dissatisfied.
My question is around the dress.
So this was one element that was in the exhibition, and you could actually listen to people also with different opinions and with different experiences of the images. Another thing where we had some participation was during the digitization project. I mean, digitization to us was never just meant to be a means within itself. I mean, digitizing something and putting it out there is just like the beginning, as Mathias said. It's the beginning of like looking at the things and working with them. And one of the things that you can do when you digitize things is that you can work with images in another way than when you have just like one by one physical images. You can start to look at images in large amounts. You can start to use images along with other data that has been digitized. You can compare, you can put images together, for instance, with censuses that tell where was people born, where did they move. You can try to put these data together. And so one of the things we made was a series of data sprints where researchers and students would get together, like three Saturdays, and form groups where they would try to analyze and then visualize the data that we put out there in new ways. And it was also informed by Lewis, as Mathias said, to try to find ways of showing what are the stereotypes, what are the blind spots, what are the things that the archives tell, and what do they not tell. And yeah, so from the beginning, we wanted people really to work for the things we put out there, and we wanted to play this active role in itself. So we invited people inside the library. They formed small groups, found out what was the story that they were going to work with. And then at the end, after these three Saturdays, they each presented their story. And I won't show you all of them. You can find them. If we put up, I'll just show one of them to you, which I find quite interesting. In this case, they were not actually working with the images. They were working with the censuses. So the information, this is from the 1841 census of St. Croix. And so, they visualized, for instance, where did people come from? Can we move on to another one? There used to be something on the travel page where you can see, yeah, up here. Into the catalog in order for people is to try to find more information about some of the images that we don't know a lot about. So we've been walking around these days with the students, trying to find the locations that some of them are easy, of course, at the fire. In the streets, it's more difficult. We went with Vaughn Belle today. We did the Frigga tour. It's been a very important part of it to try and find images from Hospital Street, from the Frigga area, in order to see how it looked before. And so, yeah, we've been working with the students around that. We've also been with David trying to retake some of the photographs. We went to the old children's home that we had on a postcard here, Riverside, now the hotel, and some of the students trying to find the exact place to be in, and retook the image, and we talked about how this place looked 100 years ago and how it is now. Yeah. And so I had the pleasure of working with David, that is going to take over now and speak more about what he experienced. He came to my office, and we worked together this spring in starting the process that we are now working with the students, of actually finding the places where the images were taken and adding this metadata. And drinking a lot of coffee. So,
David Berg from Temporite. It's a little different in the change of speakers. So most people know me as a photographer, black with images. I'm known for the underwater photography. I also work at the National Parks doing archival photos for them in the past. And originally went to Denmark in the centennial events for an art show and found myself in the rabbit hole of the archives, which I'm going to speak a little bit about right now, and how I've been trying to make the resources a little bit easier for to come back home to the Virgin Islands, be able to showcase it more, and there'll be many others I'll be able to add to the metadata as I've been helping with many things we've got before. So, originally I went to Denmark, I said, for the centennial event, and then I went back for a symposium that Katrine was hosting about the archives, where I spoke about my family's personal history of the connection with Denmark. And due to a family member that passed away recently, or in the past, he was able to trace our family lineage all the way back to the first Berg in St. Thomas. And so I had an idea or a baseline where to start looking in the archives, which was an advantage that many others do not have. And decided to take advantage of that, and with Katrine, started going through and looking for different resources. And then I met Mette Kia, who introduced me to the actual database that's online. So we've been here a lot tonight that a lot of the resources are already been scanned, everything, but we don't hear about that a lot in St. Croix, and found myself, as I just described, as just going through them over and over, clicking through it, but immediately realized that the way that someone in the Virgin Islands would use certain keywords to search through the database was not the way that the Danes might have uploaded or scanned it into it. So it was a little bit more difficult. And as I started going more and more through it, I realized the idea of using search words or keywords to go through the search engine, and this is the actual database of the Royal Library, was not working. For example, this was the free gut search when it first happened, and it was only like 6-7 photos, and that was not okay, because there's definitely many more free gut photos. And then also, for example, another one was Frederikstad, there was misspellings of Frederikstad, and a lot of that is based off of, they're just taking information that's on the back of the photography or the card, and just putting that in, and it's going to take a little bit more time going through it, which has been a major uptake. There's over 6,000 photos in the collection, but in terms of us searching it back home, it was not appropriate the way it was, and decided to speak to Mette Kia about it and offer a chance of maybe trying to go through it. The first photo that really had me realizing that there had to be a correction made, or just another eye to look at it. It was this photo. I was going through the archives. The title of this photograph was Queen Mary's Entry into Frederickstead. And so, first off, it's not Queen Mary, so we'll make that off the bat real clear. But immediately, someone that grew up as a panelist at the University of Islands just was humongous. So I was like, oh my God, did we just find a photo of Queen Mary? There was some Danish translation, Danish words on the back. I didn't know what it was saying. It was late at night when I found the photo. Once we translated, we realized it was actually Queen Mary's son, Hezekiah Smith, arriving back to St. Croix after his he was extradited from Florida from the crime that he committed in St. Croix. And this was actually his arrival back to St. Croix, where then he was taken to Denmark, where he served his sentence. So this photo had nothing to do in the sense of the actual Queen Mary figure, the female, but of her son. But as we also believe, she was also called Queen Mary throughout his time. So it made sense, but there was no mention in the metadata of Hezekiah Smith. And so it was something that I felt that if someone else had the same idea of going through it and found that, it would, they didn't want that same disappointment to happen to somebody else. So I decided to offer my services, and Mette Kia let me do that. Just another photo that showed that got me interested. We saw the painting that Mathias just showed. This was another photograph of Clovercrest, and if you know my family, we live near this area, and it really got me interested in digging more into the archives and having others' ability to find locations that they themselves might have a connection to. So, and this is a photo of the Royal Library, like to some of the offices I worked in when I went to Denmark with Mette Kia. So this is a screenshot of the current list that I've been creating of going through the archives and finding photos that either about the U.S. Virgin Islands, through the help of another individual, Serene, and hopefully many others, I've been actually trying to find the locations of the photographs. And my goal is to actually be able to give this resource back to the Royal Library, where they'll correct the metadata and actually put in the information that's correct in terms of locations and people. And also, if the other individuals want to be able to go through the archives and not go through all 6,000 photos, have it a little easier, that this resource will be available online to be able to use this list as a way to find photos that they might be interested in, search St. Croix a little easier, and then hopefully at the time, the same resources will be up onto the Royal Library's archives. So another part which has come up recently is that we just showed you that one database that's in the library. There's many other resources for Virgin Islanders to be able to search through the archives in Denmark, but a lot of it's not known on St. Croix or in the Virgin Islands in general. And what I want to do, or my goal, is actually help create a database of all the different archives that are available in Denmark that's been scanned online for everyone to be able to search through them. For example, the first one we just showed, and I'm actually going to show the different databases in a second, but this will give you an idea. The first one's the Royal Library Archives that we just showed you a little screenshot from. The second, which I found really interesting, I'm going to show to many others, and this is not known, a lot of all the newspapers that had any Danish history that while they were during their time here has actually been recorded, scanned, and digitalized online. So you can actually search through the newspaper database. And for someone like me that's actually been using the photographs, for example, Hezekiah Smith's photo I just showed you before, I was actually able to find the exact date of that photo based off an article written in the Avis. And that was because of this database I was able to search through. So my goal through the chat page is to be able to have a resource online that everyone be able to go here and they want to search the newspaper database, the Royal Libraries, because the only archives I've gone to so far in the totality is the Royal Libraries archives. There's actually the Maritime Museum, the National Museum, and then some other minor ones. But the National Museum also has the pre-Columbian artifacts, which is a whole other conversation. But they have actually photographed all those images and put the pre-Columbian, at least the images of the pre-Columbian artifacts online that are in Denmark. Oh, I will kind of come back to that. So, yes. Oh, I don't know what happened there. Give me one second, sorry.
Thank you.
the first database I just want to show you guys is this example. I did a quick search of Frederiksted in the newspaper database. And what's very interesting about the database, it actually scans the actual images in the text. So it's not just, you don't have to go through and just type in the date, it actually looks for keywords throughout the newspaper until it actually scans it and you actually then pull it up, print out the PDF or send their email in, and it's literally amazing. So for example, if we click on this, again, it's just a quick search of Frederiksted. It actually highlights the words that were showcasing it. So it's a very powerful tool in terms of going through the actual newspaper database. This one is, so we spoke the information that Mette Kia just showed in terms of the breakdown of the information. This is the actual resource of the National Archives documents that have been scanned. So it actually has the census records, church records, building records, property records, the Fireburn Park Court documents, not translated, but they're on this website too. So it's all online, access to everyone, and it's public. And again, hopefully in a very short time, it'll be all available online, you know, one source for everyone. And then just one more to showcase that the National Archives also created this search engine that's very similar to the newspaper one, that actually those images that have been scanned, it actually will go through the actual name, National Archives. So you type in your family's last name, or cousin's last name, and it'll actually show where is, like, the different documents from property, the birth and death certificates. And just another powerful resource. But I would say this, I've noticed that I've been able, when I do searches for that, and then go back to the actual database here, I might actually find more in here, but this is, you have to just go through page by page. So it's a little bit more painstaking. All right. Just gonna go through a couple photos of you guys that I have found interesting in the archives and what's inspired me personally also. Sorry, guys. So this particular photo, I find extremely powerful. I've always been noticed how she was faced up there, she was looking at. But something as if, and I act and I push this for everyone to go through the records, to go through the archives, and if you're gonna notice things that I've not noticed and others have to do, and that's my goal through this presentation, to have others very interested in the archives and to be able to do it. This particular photo I also found powerful because later on, noticing that this individual has something in his hand that probably was not used for something that was pleasant. And it's just a reminder of how things work. This photo I just find extremely powerful in terms of the reflection, the story that's being told. And this is another one that I just wanted to make sure that was showcased. It's on the walls printed here, but I feel it's one that speaks volumes in terms of our history. And just in terms of location here, this is Harding Duck.
Frederiksteders.
There we go. This has been painted by hand in color, but this is a beautiful shot of Frederiksted, and one that we've been using with the children to be able to find the location of where the photographer was standing when he took the photo. And this is a purple example. This photo in particular, which I think we say is Christmas fit, right? Mm-hmm. At this point, yes. Everyone that looked at this photo was packed, you think it's all the same thing. But I find extremely interesting in this photo, which is also in the wall, this particular individual right here, if you look at him carefully, he's actually Caucasian, he's white. And I felt that was something extremely powerful in a sense, because if you just look out quick glance, he's barefoot, wearing pants, just like everyone else. But it's a very different, it's not a normal photo that you see in the archive.
Why is that abnormal? Do you see a lot of, like, mixing?
Well, not in this particular moment, where in terms of the clothing are similar. So that was something to note, too, and also that the individual is also barefoot. That's not something I personally have not seen show up in terms of, there is mixing, but you would notice that there's a difference in terms of wear, clothing,
right.
And so.
That picture?
Yes.
If that picture is across the road,
yes.
You see the well?
Yes, I'll go back to
my family house?
Yes.
Where the trees are in the parking lot by the porch.
Yes.
It's interesting the buildings there, what they've gone.
Yes.
Where there's people.
Yes. this is my goal, exactly what you just did, to be able to do this and have people to find the sources. My goal towards the end of this is that actually on the Rural Library's website will not just be clicked, it'll actually have like what we could say like a Wikipedia page, and you could say, oh, that's where my family grew up. This, I know that person, that photo is this person. So it's not just about seeing it and talking about it, but we'll actually be able to apply to our own history to the database. And I think that's something that's missing currently to the archives in Denmark. We have to, I give credit towards the idea that they have scanned the images and now make them online, but now we need to add to it and learn from it ourselves or showcase what we know to the Danes. Just another powerful image. Another one that's a little bit different in terms that seems to be a happier moment in terms that was captured, in terms that she's smiling and cooking and preparing food, but it could be taken and interpreted from different individuals. And this is John Wood, like this, coming up. So anyone know where this shot was photo? This one was that took us a little bit. Anyone can guess where they think this photo is? I'll give a hint, it's on the west end, in Frederiksberg. Huh? Any guesses? Any guesses? What about the building here? Any know what we think this is? Who said the fort? Someone said the fort. Yeah, the fort. So that's Buddle Park, and then the playground would be over there. So that's just a photo that I was Serene actually over here. That was the one that pointed out that was before. I actually thought it was the person. I made it say no. But then also the note masquerader. And then I might be jumping teachers here, so I have to acknowledge him right here, Mr. Miller John. And so this was a very important photo for me when I discovered it. Or there's many others like this, and some I haven't seen before, but someone I grew up as the Muckajumbi to go over this, and particularly Mr. John was an excellent teacher in terms of the history of the Muckajumbi. It's just another resource that I have. And then I'm just going to end it on a photo I just recently created. I actually shot this during Carnival, and it shows you that my aesthetic is now becoming more and more black and white as I keep staring out at the photo. But thank you, everyone. I wish it was already online that I could just do it, I go ahead, type it, but it's going to take time and funding to get there. So as we create more interest doing this, the more chances of getting funding, so we can actually change the way the website is.
The internet.
Sorry, I just had to see if the sound was working. Okay, so my name is Katrine. I'm a visual artist based in Copenhagen. And first of all, I would like just to thank you all for coming tonight. It's really moving.
like whether he was bribing U.S. congressmen for the purchase of the sale. So see, in my family, because my grandfather was the one who knew about my family history, he died a long time ago. So we didn't really have anyone who knew about this character, but my uncle, he would always, you know, bring it up at family reunions. Yeah, we had this guy that tried to sell the U.S. Virgin Island, but nobody really knew anything about what it actually was about. So when the centennial came up and I heard that all of this material was being made available online, I also kind of went into the rabbit hole. So the presentation I'm going to do for you tonight is a video presentation which is mixing my own kind of search through the databases, because now we are talking about that all this material is made available online, but it's very difficult to search in the material. But hopefully for the future and more encounters like this, it will become easier. So one part of the presentation is a reflection on that. And I use the figure of the data thief, the data giver, which I will come back to. And it was Oshana James, that you most probably know, many of you artists here from Frederickstead, who did the voiceover for the park. Because another thing that I want to say is that when I arrived here, it's my first time to the island, but having seen all of these images online, I felt that I was traveling in this time lag, that I was walking around in black and white photographs that have become alive and colorful. But in Denmark, we only hear one side of the story. We only see one side of the coin. So to have David and Levon and Oshana and many more people visiting and talking together is extremely important to understand what we are actually looking at. So without further ado, I will try my best and...
unrehearsed.
Okay, so yeah, and we are going to be reading, so it's a bit different. To gain access to the archive, we need to get access through an archive creator or archive series. I type, nothing comes up. I type again, nothing. I go to the counter and ask for help. She types, but nothing comes up. She looks in old manuals used to index the archival records in the analog search databases. Still nothing. She tells me to write the chief archivist. This time, we'll get access through the data thief, data giver. State prison in Horsens, photographies of prisoners, 1909.
The data thief data giver is a time surfing roughneck. A shapeshifter, part human, part cyborg, a stateless, a beheaded, pardoned by a king, a fugitive, a revenant, a digital return, an orphan of a rebel queen, transported to 1917-2017 via the internet to roam the archives.
The digitization of the archive was presented as a gift.
But they thief it and disguise it as a gift.
Or rather, it is neither a gift nor a theft.
It is thief gift or a sticky gift. We will call him, her, Z, Hezekiah. He, she, Z gives you a pair of glasses and a code. The code is DT133727. Word riots, what do you mean? You're talking about the fire burn of 1878? The data teeth data giver is an electronic signal, a shadow library, a TIFF, a scanned original in 300 dpi, a song.
of people and land, entities of division, enslavement, ownership.
The data thief, data giver has an intimacy with technology because it was technology which sustained the chattel institution of slavery, making her unique in her visceral understanding and accommodation of technologies in the future.
Out of the superimpositions of man, questions start to emerge. How do the past racial hierarchies have ramifications today? What are the new sites of forgetfulness and unspeakability created by data visualization and mass digitization of the archives? How to account for the viscerality, the touch, smell, and taste, but also the pain, violence, and suffering inherent in the archival records? How do historical cartographies make for personal cartographies, building a multidimensional space, creating stereoscopes of deferred perception and memories? How do I position myself in relation to these images? Or rather, how do the archive orient and position me?
How do you, as an apparent white Dane, position yourself in relation to the archive?
The question of position always makes me shiver. Maybe because I believe that positions are not stable, but always changing and relational. However, when it comes to this archive and the current situation in Denmark, I do believe that I have to ask myself, how do I position myself in relation to these images? How does my own family history marry into the Danish colonial system?
Do you know Captain Christmas?
I met him once in a casual way. I live at the Manhattan Hotel, and I met him in a most casual way in the lobby of the hotel.
Did you ever have a contract with him of any kind?
Never of any kind of character.
Had you any connection with him in seeking to bring about the sale of the Danish West Indian Islands to the United States?
None. Either directly or indirectly or otherwise.
Did you ever bring that matter at his instance to the attention of the president?
Never. I never talked to the president on the subject.
And the only relation you ever had with this Captain Christmas is that which you have already described?
I have met him a couple of times, but I met him in the public lobby of the Manhattan Hotel where he was stopping. I do not recall who presented him to me, and the only ordinary courtesies of the day were extended. I never talked with him on any subject in relation to this inquiry.
Do you know Captain Christmas?
I have no recollection of ever having met him. I will state my belief is that I never did, but so many thousands and thousands of people come to see me here in New York, and here I would not say I had not met him.
You do not ever recollect having any conversation with him about the purchase of the Danish West Indian Islands?
No, sir. I never had a conversation with anybody on that subject matter.
Do you know Captain Christmas?
No, I believe I have never met him.
Will you state what particular relations you had with Captain Christmas?
Yes, sir. I'll be glad to do so. So one day, while roaming through the archives, I came across a report issued in 1902 by the House of Representatives called The Purchase of the Danish Islands. The report mentioned the Christmas report. operated on its own initiative and was sent unofficially by the Danish government to foresee this task. It is said that he spent the 10% of the actual sale, at that time it was $5 million, gold, and he spent the money that he thought he would get in commission for the sale to bribe the U.S. Congress. So here you see an excerpt of his statement, and here he actually used the fact that his grandfather, sorry, I'm not supposed to just, so his grandfather, John Christmas, was actually a plantationer here in St. Croix, and he used this as a reason why he feels a certain entitlement to the islands and why he has, of course, to go out and sell, because he feels that his family was the victim of the abolition of slavery. So it was the plantationers who were the victims and not the enslaved people. So yeah. Okay, so after his mission failed, he returned to Denmark, where he settled as a writer of children's books, of which the most known one is this one, Peter Must, which tells the story of a young sailor from Svendborg who's called Peter Must and who travels the world, and where he's sort of conveying this whole colonial worldview to the young audiences, and it was some of the earliest children's literature written in Denmark. So I'm going to pause the presentation here because it's a long evening. It goes on for a further 10 minutes in different directions, but I'd be happy to share it with you in the full length at another time. just on a ending note, if I have, no, I don't have more time. Then we can come back to it.
No, you don't have more time.
At the end, you know, you all can all hang out and pin her down and ask more detailed questions. I'm going to get in the way of it.
No, no, please. Juliana?
EBay these plates that were for sale, and I
came up with a list of them. I was looking online, and then I wrote to the head curator to find out if there were more plates and if I could actually see them, because I'm looking at eBay at little tiny images. And what his response to me changed the direction of my work. And he said, no, those plates are packed away and they will be sold for a very long time. So that first interaction was about the denial of access to the archives and how challenging it is for Virgin Islanders to be able to access them in that context, but even in the expense of going to Denmark to find housing, to be able to have that privilege of spending time. We don't necessarily have funding to be able to go there and do that. The second thing he had said to me was, I had found how they had logged some of the plates that specifically referenced to the Virgin Islands. But I found other things. For example, this image here is, one of the images was of a ship that was called the Jutland. And I had done some research to find that that ship, the last time it had sailed, was when the king was making the decision whether or not he was going to sell the Virgin Islands. I thought that was very significant to our story, so when I was doing my artwork, I included it in the collection. And what was interesting is when I sent the curator my list, like, this is what I found, is this true, is there more, he said that plane had nothing to do with the Virgin Islands. And that interaction taught me that different people will have different stories based on who is interfacing with these records. And he had thought that his authority was eminent, like that he had the right to say which narrative was true. And I realized that I was going to have a different narrative as a Virgin Islander, and that mine was also true and valid. And it really inspired me to want to do more of that, you know, to investigate the archives more, to figure out how as an artist, where were the blind spots, where were the stories that we were missing. So the piece that I had created based on that experience was I had collected all of the different plates that I had found that referenced the Virgin Islands in some way, and I redrew them onto paper plates. And this series was called Collectible. We can go to some of the next images. And of course, what do we do with paper plates? We throw them away when we're finished with them. And that, to me, had really symbolized the way the Danes had approached their relationship with the Danish, their former colonies, not just as a space, but as a memory. You know, what's interesting is, as I mentioned, that was the Royal Copenhagen. And I guess it's almost 10 years later, I was able to work with this company. I pitched them a project in 2017 to try to create, one of the places I didn't include in my collection when I did my piece was the 50th anniversary plate. And it was like a sugar mill, it was very colonial. I thought, you know what, for the centennial we could do something better. And I had suggested that I had been doing a series of Cheney paintings where I took the fragments and pieced them together, and I had suggested, well, maybe you know, we could make a centennial plate that used some of my artwork. It was a very, because remember, this is the same institution that had told me, no, the Royal Copenhagen is a very famous luxury brand. But they didn't accept my original proposal, but instead I was able to work with them to create a series of plates that were based on Cheney. This is the factory that I was able to work with last summer. And these are some examples of the plates, and I did a series of 12. It was very interesting for me, that experience, because it felt literally like I was infiltrating the archive. I was the first black. I remember when I had said to them, I said, I probably am the first Virgin Island artist that you've ever worked with, because this company is over 260 years old. It was first created by, to give a gift to one of the queens of Denmark. It was called the Royal Porcelain Factory, and then the name was later changed. And when I had said that to the woman that I was dealing with and interfacing with, she said, you're actually also the first black artist we've ever worked with. Which was surprising, and not surprising if you understand how Scandinavia is, but just to think that they have worked with dozens and dozens of artists, and somehow I infiltrated that space by, you know, Cheney, as many of you probably know, is not just Danish ceramics, it's Dutch, it's,
it's English, so, and their brand is so specific. So to be able to kind of infiltrate their brand, mess it up, change a new narrative and create that and still have their stamp on it was very subversive, I thought. But that trip also changed the course of my career because I fell into the rabbit hole, like Katrina mentioned. On my last 2 or 3 days, I was invited by a Danish researcher who's doing her PhD on these photographic albums. And she invited me to come with her to come see what she was doing. And I literally never left that library after that. I'm so glad I went at the end, because if I had gone at the beginning, I would have never seen anything. It was just fascinating to me. There was this image, I don't know if you guys really see it, but it was seared into my brain when I saw it, because a lot of the images, as you'll see, like some of the photographic albums are very stoic, it's the Victorian era, and you know, you see like military people going on expeditions, and here we have this black woman where there's a white Danish officer with his hand on her breast. And it was so shocking to me to see that level of ownership right here of her body, and like what's the relationship between these men and these women that are in this image. And I just never forgot. The other image that I saw was this one of this little black child, possibly a girl or a boy, in pain and crying, and in the context again of family photo albums. So this was a postcard that was circulated during that time. And at this time, here it's being presented as a photograph, but I also never forgot that image. It was so crazy to me how someone would have that in their family album. Why would this image be taken? Why would it be circulated? And when I came back home many years later, my mother was getting more ill, and we were starting to go through some of our family albums, and I came across this image of myself. And I was like, wait, that looked like, it reminded me that looked like the image that I had seen in Denmark. But, so what I had done was, I wanted to see them together. And I started using this tool of juxtaposition as a way to think about telling different narratives. And when I put these two images together, you know, thinking about the text that was on the postcard saying, Corey, pick me, D-W-I, I then took that and changed it to say Sacred Pygmy USVI to talk about many things. I mean, it's talking about, you know, in the picture of myself, it's not quite sure if I'm smiling or if I'm crying. It's a little bit ambiguous, and I think it also comments on our colonial relationship to the United States. I also really wanted to think about what it was like to see this image, which was in a kind of a public archive, and juxtapose something that was like my personal family image. And then also you get to see the difference of what happens when the lens, like the person who took this picture of me loved me. They knew me. A lot of the images that we see in the colonial archives, especially when they're taken of people of color, they're not by people who have that same affection. And so there's something revealed that's a little bit different in the pictures, in the way that the pictures are taken. And I was hoping for the juxtaposition that you would also be able to pick that and feel that. I started, of course, looking for more, and I was able to find a few others that I felt, by juxtaposing things in the public archives and the Danish archives with my personal photo albums, that you were able to tell certain stories. This one over here is, in the archives, it's labeled as Obia Mandrong, which we all know. Obia is a word to kind of describe Afro-Caribbean religious practices. And, you know, my father was a Moravian priest, which was a church that was a part of the colonizing effort. So there's this tension in these two images because, you know, you see the person that's being represented like with the Africanisms, as, you know, the way that his image is being taken is very different from my father's, who has found a way to take this religion and transform it and like represent himself. There's a lot of presence in the way that he's presenting himself. And where you see that someone else is like, their presence is being captured. It's a different feeling with two pictures. Then this one here is, this one in the records, it's labeled as a woman with child of upper class. And I thought, wow, it was so interesting because I had this picture of my mother in front of also a house holding her baby. And both images are really talking a lot about how we, all the signifiers of class movement in Caribbean societies that you don't necessarily think a lot about. I mean, it's a very, obviously it's talking about class, and here you have my mother in the 1970s in St. Thomas wearing, you know, a pantsuit and having a little baby and standing in a house that's a concrete house and a wood house, it's two stories, so we know she has a view, she's looking up. There are all these other class signifiers in that picture in the same way there is with the one from the archive. And then lastly, this image is a little bit more recent. It was taken out of one of the books written by the Lewis family members, and it says, can't really read it here, but it says, school children, their forefathers were slaves, and they're learning to be useful, as useful citizens. That text is bizarre and problematic, but when I looked at that picture, I remembered that I had a picture that had been taken of me when I lived for 1 year in Wisconsin when my father was in seminary school. And I had been othered very severely as we were the only black family in that whole town. And there was this newspaper image that had been taken of me as I was doing a craft in school. And it reminded me of that same feeling of this otherness and the way that my body had been treated in that image. So this series is called Photo Montages, and it's the irony again is just terms of the, you know, these were me kind of interfacing with the archives, and I'm really proud to say that they actually purchased this artwork, and so it's now another, it's back in the archives again. And I think it's, you know, another way that what we can reshift and retell these narratives. Next. So, going back to that first trip, and thinking about juxtaposition, at the time, it was, as Mathias mentioned, there's very little in the National Museum that deals with the Virgin Islands. At the time, there was like a small corner with about three or four vitrines. But then when I went into the National Portrait Gallery, there was this image. And of course, it just struck me. I mean, I had been searching up and down the whole museum looking for our story, and then I see this. And nobody, everybody here would know this is obviously somebody from the Virgin Islands. And you know, from the wearing the jewelry to the dress, have everything about it. And then when I came back home, I had seen an image in the Wind Plantation Museum of this countess. And she's holding a little black dog, which, you know, kind of like even how it is now, like when Paris Hilton's, you know, people, certain class of women would walk around with these little she dogs as a form of showing their class. And when I wanted to see those two images together because they reminded me of something, not just in the juxtaposition, but in the stories that they told. So this piece is called The Countess, the Negro, the Dog, and the Baby. And it's really about trying to flatten out the archive, flatten out the hierarchy that's being created in these two images to also reveal them and tell new stories. Because of course, you know, this picture isn't really of Neki. It's really of the baby. She's a prop, you know, in the same way that the dog is being used as a prop. But then at the same time, by juxtaposing them, you get to see the power of the composition of these two images that I found really interesting. And then here's another piece that I've done. You know, that collectible piece that I showed you was, you know, it was a turning point piece for me, and I've had a lot of people ask me to show it, and it was actually purchased by a Danish institution, but another institution wanted to show it, and I couldn't. And this was a unique experience for me, because they were like, they so desperately wanted the piece that they kept asking me, like, can't you do an edition? Can't you do another one? Can't you do this? Can't you? And so it forced me to really think about going back into the archives, because I, you know, it fit very well in their exhibition, this idea of the plates, and I haven't really revisited that in, you know, over almost 10 years. So I started going back, and I learned that there was a plate series that was done in the 1830s by the current king of Denmark to kind of outlay his kingdom. And there was over 80 plates that were done. And so I want, excuse me, there, again, is there any plates that dealt with the Virgin Islands? And out of the 82, there was one explicitly that dealt with the Virgin Islands, and it was this one of you know, St. Thomas. And as I had been researching, researching, and as you can see, a book had been done about the collection, and I had a chance to interface with the author. As a painter, the visceral experience, I first thought, okay, well, just like how I did the collectible work, I'm gonna recreate it on paper plates. That was my strategy. I thought, okay, I'll do that again. As I was starting to do it, it just felt off because the colors were off. I remember thinking like, well, that's not really what the Caribbean looks like. Especially as I was looking at the other pictures, I just said, well, so I wrote to the author and I said, did the painters of these plates, these two guys, did they ever come to the Virgin Islands? Because he'd been researching their journals, their diaries as they traveled throughout the Danish kingdom. And he said, no, it doesn't really seem to be that there's any evidence. What they probably did was they did a conglomerate of various images, pieced them together, and created this plate. And I was like, look at that, well, it makes sense to me, because the plate, there's something just that feels imaginary about the image. The piece that I created was thinking about that fragmentation, you know, thinking again about almost an inverse of my chain of pieces where I'm taking fragments and putting them together into one. Instead, what I did was take this image and fragment it out so that you see that there are holes in the images, that it's shifting, that when you even display this artwork, I mean, it's about 45 to 50 plates. When you display this artwork, it will never be displayed ever the same, ever, because every time it will kind of shift and move, and I thought it was a good way to kind of represent that these were illusions and fragments and had holes. So this was invited into an exhibition last year in Denmark, and imagine my surprise that as I walk through the exhibition, I see this image. Because I'd spent several weeks painting this, making this artwork, I knew this vista pretty well. So I walked up and I went, oh my God, this is the same image. And as the text illustrates, it says there's a view of St. Thomas, and I think there's one, is there another text? No. But basically it was a print of a painting. So it was a copy of a copy. It was proving the point that the author had also thought, as well as I did, that the image that had been created was really like a projection of a copy of a projection. And it was interesting again because the curators hadn't noticed that. My piece was in the piece, and this lithograph was somewhere else in the show. And when I brought it to their attention, everybody was just so shocked that here it was in the exhibit, kind of the other vista that the painting is, that my work was based on. Moving out a little bit, but I started this renovation project in 2011 when I purchased a building, and I didn't even know what I had purchased, to be honest. It was George Tyson who came to me after and said, we'll do some research on this building. I had bought it because it was cheap, and I wanted a studio space, and he said I would do some research on the building, and then he called me up 2 weeks later and showed me this list of the previous owners going all the way back to 1777, many of whom in that era were African born. And it made me think about my own building in a really different way. I was so surprised. He talked to me about Free God and the whole area, and that your house is not that unique. I mean, all of these buildings can have this story. And it was so shocking to me that I didn't know that, as somebody who's a culture producer, and why are these stories so not told? And I started a project called The House of Freedom Built, which is a combination of advocacy and a renovation and a blog and a documentary. But what happened is that, what happened is because I had done such intimate, I did a lot of renovation myself. So I developed this very intimate knowledge of the materials and the space, and that led to some other projects. And I started to really think about these architecture as a type of archive, not just holding all these stories, but how the materials, not just the stories of the people that own the building, but the materials themselves held stories. So when I was sitting outside in my studio, the outhouse was in a ruin, and they had these coral stones that were there. And enslaved were sent into the ocean during the low tide to go and collect the coral, and that forms a lot of the foundations of the buildings, but that we don't see that. And that how the labor of those enslaved Africans really not just forms a literal foundation, but they form a symbolic foundation of these society, of our society and the European societies as well. But that was like invisible because it's on the bottom and you only really see it when the Danish brick on top is in ruin. So I created this piece actually that was called Trading Post, and it was in response to thinking about creating a monument for the centennial. What it is collecting a lot of the stones that were outside of my studio and thinking about, instead of creating a sculpture that had a top, like to really think about the sculpture as the base in and of itself, and that these would tell the stories of the formerly enslaved and their legacy. I also, again thinking about how the material itself was a type of archive, did a project that was called wall rubbings, a record of the work of others. And so this, first of all, this wall is amazing because it really kind of shows this juxtaposition of the coral stone and the Danish brick. And so what I did was I used a type of paper, and if you're going to a cemetery and you want to do a rubbing to kind of record something as a way of having a memory of it. And so for me, I started creating these artworks. I recreated that wall by kind of creating this rubbing and wanting again to create a testimony of the people whose hand touched these coral stones. I'm just going to end with talking about, this is my studio, we can go on. So I'm going to end with talking about some of the latter pieces that I've been working on, which is called Cuts and Burns. And it's thinking about, again, the buildings as a type of archive and how these buildings are predicted, especially in the different because of the fire burn and the town was rebuilt during the era where the Victorian gingerbread was very prevalent. And I started thinking about, how the buildings had the testimony in them and how could I recreate that visually as an artist. So here is just my first iteration of this project where it's taking a tool that can cut and burn into paper and recreating these patterns and thinking about them as a record of not just the resistance, because that's what cutting and burning was. It was a form of first colonial tools. When you came to the land, you slashed and you burnt it to dominate it, but then the workers and the enslaved took those same tools as an act of resistance. And how could I use that as a visual tool myself as an artist? So this work comes out of that, and it's a form of documenting the resistance, but also the pain. Because if you think a lot about what people do and their pain, they have this phenomenon of cut and burn themselves, so the piece also speaks to that. And I like the fact that it was able to be an archive and a document of both of those things. So I'll just end with showing some of the others. This is kind of a wall hanging. This is another version of it. Sentinels, which was shown in the Royal Library exhibition. This is kind of halving some of the pieces and making these other smaller, more intimate objects with them. And this is the ledger series, which are these long, like 9-10 foot ledgers, which is another type of writing and documentation in schools. And then lastly, I have a piece which I hope, this is a smaller version which I hope to make bigger. The idea was always a bigger one, but this is called Constructed Manumissions, which are taking the same gingerbread front work and creating these kind of enclosed magical spaces, these protected spaces. Because when I thought a lot about like Free Gut and the house that I have my studio in, and you think about how people's freedom was so tenuous, that these houses meant so much to them, and I wanted to kind of try to recreate that in an artwork. So I think I'll end here. the reason why I want to end with this last project is because I think it speaks to kind of the overall, I want people that when we think about the archives that we also have to question them. This is a kind of a longer story and I'm going to try to tell you in 2 minutes. but because of the work I had been doing in Free Gut, there was a woman who wrote a book about sort of Danish architecture, and she included my work in her book. And she interviewed me, and then I found out later that there might have been some mistakes in the way that she documented my story. Namely, she said that I inherited my properties and that I was related to the woman from the 1700s. And as that's a beautiful story. Wouldn't that be a beautiful story? But it's not my story. It's not true. And I was so shocked that she took my interview and then put it in a book in this completely different way that I did not tell her. And it was such a violating experience. And we had engaged in a series of emails over the course of 6 months trying to figure out what happened. It was a very like first like how could this happen, and let's I want to work out how did you make that mistake. Like I accept your apology, but how did you do that? And it was a very frustrating experience. As I said, it went over 6 months, and then finally I was still left feeling very, very powerless because the book is out, it's in public, and it's wrong. And although it was she gave me a private apology, it was a very public error, and my story was completely hijacked. And anyway, I at one point realized that art had the power. I had the power. You know, we play that game, rock, scissors, paper. But I realized art actually had the power to interface and to maybe interface with the power that a book had. And so what I did was, on the last email that I sent her, I gave her a very long explanation about some of the things that I just said, about the violation, about why why her narrative was so wrong and how it revealed a real blind spot in her, even as an expert, to think that I could have an unbroken lineage to people in the 1700s. That she was missing all of these things as an expert. And this is now a document that people are going to read in history and think that it's real and true. And so I published our emails and juxtaposed it with her book. And it was very controversial, because a lot of people thought, oh my God, that's a private interaction you guys had. Why would you make that public? And I said, but that's what the archives are. A lot of them are letters, they're photographs that belong to people. And I really wanted people to see how Virgin Islands stories can often be changed and shifted, and how we could still even have them today. I'll end it.
Questions of any of the presenters, now is a good time. If anybody really needs a drink of water, the cooler is right behind me and there's some glasses on top, and I might even be able to go get it and stretch over and get it for you. Any questions, comments? Hi, Ken. The PowerPoints are going to be online.
Try to make a list of the links and stuff, because like for instance the exhibition, the blind spot exhibitions, we have some catalogs you can look through. No, but we can send it to you individually, because it will be difficult because of all the copyright and stuff to find agencies that can find ways.
And then like I know Katrine is an artist at piece of artwork. Done in Denmark, in Copenhagen.
So that'll be Saturday at 11 at the Museum Center. That's why I didn't want you to go. Okay? You want one for Africa House? Excuse me. We have a few flyers that we can share. And there's another really important and great presentation, and we have some fabulous people in our midst. Tomorrow, through the Friends of the National Park, there will be a presentation at UBI at 5:30 by members of, and please stand, the Society of Black Archaeologists. Dr. Oluwale, Dr. Donovan, Dr. Llewellyn, and where we are the rest. And friends and associates, and so they'll be presenting on the work.